Good evening, Hajar. It's so nice to see you. How are you today?
Thank you, Professor. I'm fine.
So what I'm going to do is begin with an introduction of the project and of you, and then we'll continue the conversation that we started a couple of weeks ago. Let me read your bio. Hajar Abulfazl is originally from Kabul. Did I pronounce Kabul correctly, or is it Kabul, Afghanistan?
Kabul or Kabul is good.
I've heard both. Okay, thank you. And now lives with her husband in Oakland, California. She moved to the United States in July of 2017. She speaks Farsi, also known as Dari, and English. Hajar started her studies at Montgomery College in the spring of 2019. She is majoring in community health at Montgomery College and is taking classes remotely. She anticipates graduating from Montgomery College in the fall of 2023. Hajar coached soccer in Oahu, Hawaii last year. Wow, that's great. Today, she works as a soccer coach and as the coordinator of a girls' soccer program with the nonprofit organization Soccer Without Borders. And in her spare time, she enjoys playing soccer, hiking, and exploring San Francisco and other parts of California. So a little bit of background for those who are watching this video, if they did not see the first one, my name is Heather Bruce Satrum. I teach in ELAP, English Language for Academic Purposes, at Montgomery College. This project is called History in the Making, documenting stories of immigrant and refugee students at MC. And the goal is to help others better understand the experiences of immigrant and refugees in Montgomery County, Maryland. Telling your story will enable others to better understand the challenges that immigrants face and better appreciate the resilience and perseverance of people in your community. So I'm so grateful for your participation. Thank you.
Thank you for reading that bio, and I am very excited to continue this conversation with you.
Me too. Today is Friday, April 14th. It's about 5 p.m. This is the second of two interviews. The last time we spoke, we talked about your experience growing up in Afghanistan. Today, we'll have a chance to build on our earlier conversation and talk more about the work that you're doing in Oakland, California with Soccer Without Borders. You had a chance to read the interview questions in advance, but please note that all the questions are optional. If you want to skip a question, that's fine. If you need a break, please let me know. And we'll take about an hour to talk today. So first, could you state your full name for me, please?
Spell is Hajar Abulfazl, H-A-J-A-R, and the last name A-B-U-L-F-A-Z-L.
Thank you. And do I have permission to record this interview?
Yes.
Thank you. All right. In our last conversation, you told me about how you started playing soccer in Afghanistan, about playing for the women's national team of your home country, about traveling to other countries. Could you tell me a little bit more about that, like where you went when you were traveling with your team and how that travel experience affected you?
Sure. When I selected for the national team, that was 2009, and I started to travel with the national team. First, that was Germany, because Germany had like 5 years contract with the football Afghanistan women's national team to have a training every season for 25 days. Then I went for two times there. Then I had time to go. What the other international competition was in some Europe countries was Germany, Norway, and the Asia. We have more competitions was like in like Qatar, like Jordan. A lot of them was and were at the South Asia, like Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, India, Nepal. And for all of those one, I had a very good experience. The most favorite one was when we had a friendly match with the Qatar national team. That was 2011, and we won 2-1.
That must have felt great.
It was really good, and I felt like that was the only one of the best match I had for Afghanistan.
And I think what is so remarkable about that story is how soccer opened up all these doors for you to learn about other cultures, other languages. Can you maybe tell us a little bit about how your world opened up through this travel, like what you learned about yourself or what traveling enabled you to do as far as growing and becoming who you are now? How did it affect you?
Oh, very good question, Professor. Traveling made my vision wider. Like I was thinking, or I had a plan to graduate from high school, just go to university, or just continue my playing soccer. But I didn't know how much I can expand my plan or how much I can make bigger my vision for my future. But soccer, through soccer and through like these international traveling, I could meet more people and I can read more bio or meet a lot of different people with different backgrounds and who are there working for the soccer or beyond soccer. I learned so much from so many peoples around the world, like which was Europe countries, Asia country. Even I came to United States a few times for training camp in California. Then all these combined like made me to have a more positive attitude or positive vision for myself, for my life, because everybody has a different experience or different culture and different challenges. But these experience make everybody or made myself a better person to, I can stand for myself and I can speak about my challenges, speak about my problems, or even after a few years of working for Football Federation, they made me as an advocate to not just stand for myself and also fighting for the others' rights and speak about them to get their rights, which they deserve it. And all these ones, I'm sure the culture from the like Middle East and the South Asia made more to make me more a better person, to because my family or my country was similar with these countries we visited, but I brought so many experience to my team and I bring to my school and share with all my classmates, share with my teammates, because then they couldn't and they didn't have the chance to travel. But I was kind of a messenger to bring the message from the other side of the world or from other countries in the class, in the school, and in the team, which make their mind also open as I did for myself, which was a really good experience. And I am so happy. And it was not just playing soccer that opened a lot of opportunities for me to, I could travel. I can participate to some international conferences or international workshops to build and receive capacity and the other, not playing soccer, the other knowledges too.
When you're describing this, I'm thinking about how when you traveled, you were learning about different cultures, but you were also teaching others about your culture. And you were teaching others about what it means to be an Afghan woman. And I think certainly here in the United States, we have a lot of images from the media about women living under the Taliban. And we have these ideas of women in burqas being isolated, staying at home. And you were and are projecting a very different image. You know, you're projecting an image of a very strong, independent, athletic, articulate woman. You have this chance to show the world that Afghan women are more than just the stereotypes that we see. So I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit about your experiences, if you have felt stereotyped by others, that do people have these preconceptions about what it means to be a woman from Afghanistan, and how do you teach others about the reality of what it means to be a woman from Afghanistan?
Yes, I felt it and I experienced that the other countries as well, they don't know a lot of about Afghanistan. Like, as you mentioned, we are just watching the news. They're just sharing specific news or specific subjects to the people, but they're not sharing all details and all maybe in a good view for the people. But when I had the chance to travel, the people was thinking we always have burqa, there is no freedom, there is no school, there is no playing sport. And even they didn't think about it that we are willing to have a like work outside of home, because like many years the media gave them to, because the Taliban regime or other regime in Afghanistan like put us in a shelter to we cannot work or we cannot go to school. But that was a good chance for me to, when I go and see the other peoples and I can experience, I can share my experience from Afghanistan about food, music, women rights, and all the activities we have. Specific, like 2015, 2016, I had more travel to, like I went to Japan, Germany, Norway, like Denmark, all these countries, and I had seminars, like workshop, and I had the chance to talk with a lot of people, one-to-one or one as like big groups, and the most common question all of them has was like, if anyone is working in a government, anyone is working outside, do you have right to choose your school? All like these kind of, when I said yes, because we are in Afghanistan, but I feel we are more freedom. We have more freedom than other countries. I'm talking about like 5-6 years ago.
Yeah.
We have more freedom than other countries. Like Iran is our next, or the Saudi Arabia or Middle East countries. I felt it. I have more freedom than other countries like in our region, because we had that right to go to a school, and we had right to go to any university we want, and also in if we want to go to a stadium and watch the game, we had that chance, and there was a specific place for all the female or family to come just sit there and watch the football, which few countries in the Middle East or in the South Asia, they don't have that, and the government banned to not, they cannot go to the stadium, but we had that one. Plus that time 37% of women was working for the government at the leadership part. In the parliament we have more than 37% of was parliament was women, and we have minister, we have ambassadors, we have a lot of doctors, and which those ones made me happy, and also it's good to share with the people to, yes, woman has that right to go outside and make history for them, and make a pathway for the next generation to come and follow that one. And we had that as you mentioned, that stereotype to women is just staying home and they should be at home, but those one was like for longer ago, which I received when I was starting playing soccer, and it said you are belong to the kitchen, you are belong to stay home, you're not belong to in the green field, which is like soccer field. Mm-hmm. You're not belong here, just go where you belong. Like that means that you belong to the kitchen, just cook and raise children. But with all of those messages we received, but we had that chance, or we had that ability to show ourselves in the social participations or communities to, yes, we can do, be a part of the society, part of making that country in a better country.
From what I've read about your time as a professional soccer player, I understand that you made a choice to cover your hair. You were kind of sending a message out to the world, I think, by doing that. Can you talk about the message that you were trying to convey by covering your hair while you played soccer?
There is a few reasons, but the why I love to have it, because first, I love to have it, but the second reason why I kept it, because I was there to encourage the next generation or younger generation to come to play soccer. And all families or fathers was watching me how I look. Because if you're representing something or you want to encourage people to come to you, follow your rules or follow your pathway, they will look at you, what you reached, what you achieved or what you have done. Then they will maybe convince themselves to, yes, this is a good way. That's why like I kept all the culture from Afghanistan. I kept all the value from Islam and Afghanistan. To show a better or show what they're looking for, then because our mission was not to changing completely the culture or changing the religion, but we want to make free, give a woman and girls a freedom to come play soccer, to come play any other sports they want. We didn't have the plan to change completely what is established. We kept all those value and we pursue our mission, which was increasing the number of the players, because I found soccer is a good way to fight for yourself and make yourself in a better person or earn what you want at this world. That's why I encourage more good girls in Afghanistan to come to play soccer and find your life.
In a way, it was a very visible message, I think, to young Muslim women all over the world that you could be athletic and strong and still be modest in your dress. Like, it seemed like it was a very concrete and quiet way of saying what you wanted to say. I think that was a very interesting message, the way that you did it. I think there was this period of time when many people felt really hopeful about the future of Afghanistan. And of course, the past few years have been extremely difficult. Do you have family and friends in Afghanistan now? And are you in communication with them? And if so, can you tell me about their experience now?
Yes, there is a lot of people left behind in Afghanistan. They are still living in Afghanistan, but the only difference from before is they cannot be outside of a home and they cannot go to school and they cannot continue their soccer activities, which is so hard for us to watch them. Like, it has been exactly almost 2 years. And before Taliban, it was COVID, and they stay home for a while because of COVID. It means it has been like few years they haven't been outside of home and to have activities, which is really hard. And now they're contacting me every single day, and I receiving messages from WhatsApp, like through WhatsApp, and they're sending me the pictures, sending me messages, a lot of, and that is so hard for me to receive it, and I cannot, at the same time I receive it and I'm talking with them, but I cannot do anything for them, which is harder. But all I can do is talking with them nicely and give them positive messages and give them to, this is not permanent, this is temporary, it will this regime will leave Afghanistan and then another government will come and you will have a better future very soon, like kind of like to give them hope, to just not thinking today, thinking about tomorrow. And I'm just telling them to, you have your yard or you have your room, do some activities in the room or at the house, to not just staying home or watching something. You can have some activities meanwhile, like the Taliban is there, shut down everything, but you can do something at home. And there is a lot of, like, because all of them has a social media, and I said social media is a school right now for everybody, because there's a lot of people or influencer, they are sharing good messages or good lessons to, you can just go and watch them or listen to them. With that one, you can gain knowledge or you can gain information. In the same time, you cannot go out. That's the only thing I can do for them, to just tell them these way to use these way. But the other side, I can understand them too. It's really hard to lose everything, and they're of course, I'm telling them there's hope, but right now they feel there's no hope and there is no future for them right now. And it's so hard.
But it sounds like you do feel hopeful about the future of your country.
I'm very hopeful, and I'm sure this is not the end of our freedom, and it's not end of Afghanistan. And at the same time, they came 20 years ago, and they stay in Afghanistan for a few years, but their government collapsed. And I believe this regime will collapse again very soon. And all these generation, we are here, we will go and build the country again in a better Afghanistan.
When you feel discouraged about the situation, how do you maintain your hope? How do you maintain your positive energy? What sustains you and gives you strength to keep feeling optimistic?
Always I'm saying, like, the big regimes or the big government, they never stay forever. If any government or any regime has their period, like, time, if they're coming, they will stay a few years, but they will not be forever. But we are trying to, myself, I'm trying to gain experience and gain knowledge to as soon as we can. We can, like, I'm making myself ready for that situation. If we get our Afghanistan back, our freedom, then we should be ready to go back and get the responsibility and make it. Because at the same time, if I sit and I watch the Taliban, what they're doing, and shut down for all the activities for women, and I sit and just say what they're doing and crying, it will not change anything. But if I think for the future, for 5 years later or 10 years later, then I can keep that hope or keep that plan for myself, and I can watch the future, and I at the same time learn something or gain experience for go back to Afghanistan a few years later and make Afghanistan better. That is the only thing. And I said, Hajar, you're young, and at 10 years or 5 years or even 15 years later, you can go back to Afghanistan and make it what you want.
And I think, I mean, what you said was really interesting to me. And when I'm interviewing all the students participating in this project, I'm curious about what helps with mental well-being, emotional well-being. And I'm wondering, you as an athlete, the connection between physical exercise and emotional health, is that something that's important to you that you've noticed or that you encourage of others? Like, is there a connection for you between, like, physical health and emotional health?
Oh, the very good point, Professor. That is also very important, because we have to think first ourselves, our health. Like, always, I'm at the morning. Now is Ramadan, but that if it's not Ramadan, I'm always running in the morning. If I cannot run, I will walk, but I will go outside because getting fresh air. And I'm every week I have a lot of, like, I'm practicing soccer, and if I'm not practicing, I'm going to the gym to run. Like, all these, like, I believe the physical activities is giving us a positive attitude, positive energy. That's the only thing we can do for us to keep our health, body healthy. And with writing and reading and talking with my fellows or talking with my teammates or talking with my friends in Afghanistan or outside of Afghanistan, these all included, they gave me positive energy to stay calm and not get too, like, depressed or get a negative energy. Of course, like, our body or our emotional is not always stable in one place. It will go down or maybe go high, but with having all these conversation with the peoples, or having your, like, lifestyle, like, or daily routine to have a physical activities, reading books or writing something, these ones make me happy. The other people also have something, like, maybe they have music, they have writing, or they have painting, some things to make them busy, that can make them busy and make them keep them healthy.
Another thing that some students have mentioned is the importance of spirituality or religious faith or having a community. Are those things that are also important to you?
It's really important, Professor. That's why always I'm making friends. And any city I go, like, I don't want to stay alone at home, especially the weekend. I don't want to be home. Even I have one or two friends, I'm calling them and I will take them to the park, take them to the museum, take them somewhere, and I make them plan with them. Even the easiest things I can do is inviting them at home and making food. Cooking is, the food is something to we have everybody in common, and we can make that with inviting them for eating or inviting them to have food is building community, is building relatives, friends, which is real good. Like the easiest things I can do is inviting them at home to making food with me at home.
Cooking and eating together. That sounds like an excellent plan for combating frustration or loneliness or any of the other negative emotions that I think so many people have gone through during the pandemic. And I think that recent events in your home country certainly have had a really tough impact on the Afghan community here as well. So you came to, if I remember correctly, the United States in July of 2017, is that right?
Yes.
Okay, so can you tell me a little bit about your decision to come to the United States at that point? Like what happened in your life or in your country that made you decide that year it's time for me to move to the United States?
2015, 16, like we had the government was there, but every week or every month we have a lot of explosion from the different terrorist groups. Like they said, like the Taliban or some of them, they said it's ISI, like there's targeting the army and targeting the women activists, or they're targeting those people. They're active at the government. And we were witness of every week explosion. Like they targeted, they attacked the school, attacked the mosque, or even they attacked the wedding ceremony. And that year we had like, I came in United States at the beginning of the year. And I had a 1 year visa with in my passport. Then I came two times at the beginning of the year with because of two meeting. But when I go back Afghanistan, the 3 or 4 months ago of that to make decision was I was at this school, at the medical school. And I remember we had a pathology exam, and all the student was at the big hall for the final exam. And the huge explosion happened in exactly like half of a mile away of our university. And the building was huge glasses, and with that attacked at the square of our university, all the glasses broke and all the building collapse, but not the floors, all the glasses collapsed and all the broken. And we had a lot of people injured with that glasses broken. And most of people just, they pass out over there because they couldn't, it was like shaking so badly. That time I felt, Hajar, if I was not at the school, I was out at this street, I might lose my life and I will not be alive. But and when I go home, because my father was at army and he gave me always, I had a driver and I had a car. To they took me to school, they took me to the soccer practice. Then when I arrive home, my father said, Hajar, this is done. You cannot go to the soccer practices because school I cannot stop. But I think we have to stay home for a while because those attacks was, sometimes it was like before was like one attack, but that recently, that 2017, we had more than 20 attacks in a few months. It was a lot. And we lost so many people. And my father said, and my mom also, like both of them, they said, this is the time we have to make decision to be out of Afghanistan. And any of you will have an opportunity, or any of you has already has an opportunity to leave the country, it is the time, at least one of as should be alive outside of, out of Afghanistan. We should not stay all of us at home. And if anything happened, all of us die at the same time. At least one of us should be alive. Then talking with my mom, and she gave me that permission to have to leave. Then I traveled to United States and stay here.
That must have been terrifying, what you described with the explosions. I'm so sorry that you went through that. When you came here, did you come as an international student, like on an F1 visa or through a refugee program, or how were you able to?
I came with B1 visa. It's like a tourist visa. I came with that one. Then I stay. I talked with a lawyer. Then I applied for asylum at mid-summer of that year.
Was that a long and complicated process? I'm trying to imagine the bureaucracy and what was involved. I think a lot of Americans don't know
the process at all. That's a big story, or this is a long story, Professor. And there is the procedure of the being a refugee in the United States is, first of all, is not easy, and it is not short time. It has been a long time, because now I came here, but my other teammates or my other friends, they went to the another countries, like Europe countries, like Canada. And they got opportunity to, they finish all the paperwork and all the procedure of the immigrant at that country so quickly and easier than me. But in United States, it's really complicated, and I don't know how explain it, why it is so complicated, and it is such a long time to just wait and to receive one paper or receive your being asylum, or you're granted, or even sometimes so long you're not granted. It has been exactly more than 6 years, Professor. I couldn't receive any granted document from the country to they granted me as a refugee here, and that's why I couldn't finish my school, because I couldn't receive any benefit from the government. As like I have not received zero benefit from the country as a refugee here. I work and I earn money and I go to school. I did all of them for myself, or I work like more than 40 hours sometimes to just earn money to pay my rent or pay my grocery, and I have never received anything from the government. Only I receive one paper, that is the work permit, and that's all I receive. And it's so hard. And all my family, all my friends, family, they left the country after me. They already granted and they already receive as a refugee status, but in here in the United States, they put you. They give you one letter and I keep you like a long time here. And I lost a lot of opportunity for being here. If first my life was in danger in Afghanistan, that's why I left it. But if I was safe, or if my country was safer, and I believe that I could work, or I could gain a lot of more experience, or I can gain a lot of achievements from international, because I lost a lot of opportunity in the so many countries they invited me as a speaker, as an attendant to that conferences, or even I lost I missed a few international competition with my national team. I couldn't go and join them because I didn't have travel document. And I applied and I paid for the travel document 2 times. And unfortunately, they rejected because they said there is no emergency reason for you to travel out of United States. But if you go out of United States, you cannot come back to the United States. It means you will lose here, and you will the other side, you will lose the other opportunities too. Like kind of like I cannot explain it and how this procedure is. The only thing is really hard, and I cannot believe this country made this system for the refugee to come and experience this one the same time. They want to help the Afghan refugee, and they're shouting or they're sharing all these one to their helping refugee, but I haven't seen any help.
Thank you for describing that, because I think it's something that a lot of Americans don't realize, just how time consuming and expensive and complicated the process is. So I appreciate you describing that. And I'm sorry that's been your experience. We're really lucky to have you. And I'm glad that you stuck with it and that you're here, because I think you are contributing so much. And I do want to talk to you about your work with Soccer Without Borders, because I think it's really interesting. Can you tell me a little bit about the organization and how you got involved with it?
The Soccer Without Borders, I wish I found this a few years ago, so I can spend more of my time at this organization, but I am lucky I found it last year. I have a LinkedIn account, and then I'm following some organization at that account, and I saw this nonprofit announce it. We are looking for they open for hiring. Then I read the description and I said, oh, this is so fit for me, and I am very fit at this position. Then I applied for the Colorado state, but when I applied, they said, Hajar, I had the two interview, and when I passed the two interview and the third, they said, Hajar, I think we are very happy to have you at the California and the state of Colorado. And they sent me the description for being at the California and being coach and as a coordinator program with the newcomers, like especially Afghan girls. Then when I read it and I said, yes, it's exactly what I'm looking and I love to be here. Then they hired me to online, and I moved from Hawaii to California, and I started my job here beginning of January 2023. Then it has been 3 months almost that I'm working with them, and I found it exactly. I feel like I live or I build it for this job or for being here, because I gain experience for past few years as a refugee in different states of United States. And plus I have experience from Afghanistan working for Football Federation and playing soccer all in combined. And I am very good fit at this position, because we are here working with the refugee for newcomers to make place a home for them. Like the soccer is the tool we are using to make their life better and make them make a positive life or make a good community for them to don't feel or then not feel alone or not feel isolated in their places. That's why we keep talking with them, recruiting new players and going to the school and talking with their teachers. Take the time from the half or 10 minutes or 15 minutes off of the different classes to just go there and present and introducing our program and introducing ourselves to the girls to if they like to come play soccer, and inviting them there and give them home. Like I really happy I am here, because as I said, those experience, now I don't want these newcomers, they felt or they're they face the same experience and I had. That's why I want to help them a lot, give them a very good view from this country, or because this what I said about the government, all those, but there's a lot of good people around here. They really love people to help them and give them job, give them assignments, they give them like just make them busy in a good way to they can learn something, they can gain experience, which is really good. And here we are just asking to come play soccer, but at the same time is not we are focusing to play make them a professional soccer player. At the same time we want them to provide a community to they feel home. like feel me like a sister or like a mom or anything, like they want, just feel it. And I am always there for them too if they need help for like mental health or physical activities or anything they want to have it. We are here. Even like 2 days ago, like one of the girls, they said, I asked them what make you happy so I can do it here for you. They said, Hajar, shopping is really make me happy. And I said, I will take you to some of the grocery, to some of the clothing or the some shopping. If you know a specific one, I will take you there. But if you don't know, like I will take you to the mall or somewhere to you can just walk around, because it has been 6 months. She arrived to the United States, she received some documents and she joined the school, but she didn't see dark outside. She hasn't seen night of United States because she is afraid to go outside and she doesn't have car and there is no other person or there is no other community to take them to somewhere like in a park or somewhere. And just she said, Hajar, it has been 6 months, I haven't seen dark. It means all the nights she's staying home, just go to school and come back about 3 o'clock. Before night, they are all home and there's no ride. That's why, like I said, okay, I'm making some fun days. We call fun days. The fun days is like we take them to the trip, like for hiking, for beach days. We take them to like go golfing, do anything they make them happy. We will take them, like as I said today, we have gardening. We bought a lot of stuff to just make them like seeds and also soil, everything over there to they make their plant, any plant they like, they make it them and they plant, painting the ways they have. All these things, I know it is really simple, but I believe that is really good because make them happy, because they want to just be out of home. They want to just be out of that the home they are, because they want to talk with new people. They want to talk with new people, new teammates, all those. And I working here, I can find the dots from here to the Afghanistan experience I have. And I'm really lucky I'm here and I want to try my best to make them a very happy and a good community here, because they deserve to be happy and they deserve to be safe and healthy.
So is the program based at Oakland International High School? Is that where you're focusing your work with that community?
Yes, like our office in California is all Oakland, but I will be at Oakland International High School, and I will start with middle school in Roosevelt Middle School. I will go and because they receive newcomers over there too, and I will work with two schools. Like my
newcomers, where are they coming from? Are they also from Afghanistan or from other countries? Can you describe a little bit the population?
The population we have, like Oakland International High School, we have from any place from this world. Even we have from Ukraine, from Afghanistan, from Yemen, from different countries, from Middle East, like from Syria, from Jordan. And the majority of our participants are from South America, like Guatemala, like
Venezuela.
All like South America countries, we have a majority of our participants.
I think what's particularly powerful is that you have lived it. You've gone through this experience and they can see you and how much you've accomplished. So even a simple thing like a soccer practice or going on a shopping trip or planting a garden, these little activities with you, I think can be pretty powerful. And a way to start forming a community.
Yes, and today, like one of them, they said, Hajar, you're so like, I have so much energy and your English is really good and your attitude is so positive. when you're coming to the class and you said, hello, everybody, like always how he can, how we have this positive energy or this much energy. Like, I wish we have half of that one. And like, we are watching you like a role model. Like, we want to like have that energy like you. One of them I had not therapist or not a psychology class, but we are sitting with our participant one by one to talk with them and what is the challenge they have, what is the problem they have in family, out of family or home or out of home. And she said, Hajar, I'm not a shy person and I am not so quiet, but here made me quiet. Here I cannot be like who I am. And I said, it is normal. It is not kind of like it's this country gave you, but yes, because you came from one culture to another culture, and it's so hard and it takes time to you adapt yourself to this culture. First, the food is not the same, the culture is not the same, the people are talking like speaking different language, and all these combined make you like too quiet. And I know you are so you're so active, and I know you're looking to fly again higher and higher, and I am here to support you. Don't feel like that too, you're shy, but as much as you can talk with the people, if you see anyone, talk with them, make friends, and they are like the same like you. You're newcomer from one country, then there are other people there coming from the other countries. Make friends, and we are here to support you in any way. Just tell me what we can do. And I want to talk with them more and to know what they're looking for, what they desire to. If I have that power, make that happen.
I remember how much positive energy you had when you were in my class. So I absolutely agree with what they're saying. I think it's very inspiring. And I love that about you. One thing I think that is particularly interesting about your experience is that you have been to many parts of the United States. You've had a chance to see different regions of the United States and get an idea of how diverse our country is in terms of geography and culture. And has that surprised you a bit, like how diverse the United States is? Have you, what are your thoughts about that, having lived in Maryland and Hawaii and California now? Tell me a little bit about your impressions.
As you say, like, yes, there is like the United States is a big country and they have a lot of different culture we have, or different communities. I live in New York, I live in Washington, D.C., I live in Virginia, in Maryland, and even in Tennessee, California, and Hawaii, all of them. And I know it is not easy for anyone to move from one place to another place. I heard like so many people, they born in the same city, and they grow up and they live all their life in the same city, and they don't want to move. And they feel this is the big risk to take it and move to another state. But I feel like I am a traveler, and I came, I missed, or I lost everything I have in my country, and I came here with one baggage, and that was like few clothes or few books I had, and I didn't have anything else, but I built a home here for myself. If I go from one state to another state, it's really easy for me. It's like, this is nothing. But why I love to move to new places, because I want to make more community, I want to meet more people, and I want to expand my networks and expand my communities and learn more from different peoples. This is one reason. Another reason, like, I'm looking for opportunities for job or school. If I find it, I don't think about where is the destination or where is the place. I want to just go and focus that. Like, even when I moved to Hawaii, it was the reason to play coaching soccer over there. Then it was from Maryland to Hawaii. It's farther from Afghanistan. But I took that risk and I moved there, and I go there, and I didn't have any home, and I didn't have even single friend over there. No one. I just arrived, I landed to the airport, took the year baby and looked for an apartment, and I found it, and I continued my life over there. Even when I found this job, and I said, okay, this is my mission. I have to be around my people, around people to serve them. I cannot stay here and just coaching for like few people, which is so interesting for me. And I had fun over there, but my vision or my, I feel my personality is to work with the bigger groups or bigger communities. And when I felt like, when I heard the Afghan community came in California and they need support, and I said, Hajar, this is the time you must go and support them, because of the language I have, the experience I have, the experience from Afghanistan and United States combined, like it can help more people, then that's why I'm here. And about the communities, I could say like I am lucky to have good people came to me, like from United States, even the Tennessee, like or anywhere I go, like the community was very nice and kind with me, and they were so generous with me. I wish the government was generous like that much. The people are generous.
There were so many challenges during the pandemic for everyone, but I think one good thing that came out of the pandemic was increased opportunities for remote education. So I think it's wonderful that you're able to continue taking classes through Montgomery College and you're still pursuing your job opportunities and you're still able to travel and yet you just keep going. I think that's one good thing that came out of the pandemic. When I think about you and your example, one question I have for you is, if you met a new student at Montgomery College who was just starting, perhaps someone who just immigrated to the United States or is a refugee, what advice would you give them?
Advice would be I will tell them to find community that works with you, with your expertise, like find NGOs, nonprofits, or center or support to support your career. And because when I came here, like the problem I had, that was the people make me feel I was like an incomplete state because I was a refugee. They made me feel that I cannot do like anything. And whenever I tried to achieve something big, they were telling me, you're newcomers, that this is, you know, like this is kind of beyond your reach. That's why I want to tell the newcomers to look for organization that does not look at you, look at your paperwork, look at your experience, if you're legal or not. You're a refugee or you're US citizen or you're not, their goal are help you at building your skills and expertise that bring with you such an organization like I'm working here, like Soccer Without Borders, because which I unfortunately I didn't find sooner. But if they are right now, I advise them to look for these nonprofit centers. And even in the college, even in their schools, there is some centers or the office. Go there and talk with them and share your experience, share your plans. I believe there are some people that they can guide them well and guide them to where they can go and make them happy.
Were there any resources at Montgomery College that you found particularly helpful?
It was really helpful. One of them was the Future Link. They came there. There is a nonprofit. They help, and they have it's like short period time, but they give you training to who, like about your personality, about the personality, and like as a being a mentor over there and guide you to where you want to work or which major you want to choose. They give you like a counselor also that helped me at the MC. Plus the counselors are really helpful. And I really I want to appreciate my English professors. they gave me a lot of confidence, honestly, professor. Like I received more confidence at the school. It wasn't out of school, but my English professors was really helpful, and still I have contact with them, and I love them so much, all of them. One of them are you, and my other professor, Miss London, and all of you gave me that feel to receive and achieve something, which I had a lot of challenge that time to learn the language, at the college. But I think with receiving the messages or receiving the emails from the professor make me so happy. That was the only things I at the United States and the college. I think
we feel very lucky to have students like you. I think when working in this program, I had the opportunity to meet extraordinary people like yourself. And to me, it's very obvious that immigrants to this country contribute so much, but there are many Americans who don't have that opportunity to meet people from other countries or to really get to know their stories. I think my question is, if you could, what is it that Americans should know about the experience of coming here? What is it like, if for an American who was born and raised here, maybe their family's been here for generations, what do they not know or not understand about your experience?
They don't know like what I experienced personal. They feel like, I know United States is a very developed country, and they had experience longer than us in Afghanistan. But I would love to tell the people to trust the generation that came from Afghanistan here. Not only Afghanistan, the other countries. Because what I mean, we had a lot of challenge in the country, from the family, from the society, from the government, because of like the economic problems, the education system was the problem, like the outside of being home was a lot of problems. But we built a good life, and we receive experience in that country, and we make us as an ambassador, as a minister, or being working in a part of the government, and we gain that experience. When we are coming in United States, I know this is not equal or not, we don't know the system in United States, but that means that's not that we just born here. We had experience, and we still have them, and nobody can take us away from us. But I want to anyone in any organization or any centers not seeing any refugee or anyone as a refugee, as a new like to they born here.
They're newborn.
They have experience, and they had a lot of challenge, and they passed, and they achieved that to come here. It's not easy to come to United States. Like if you see like United States are not giving visa to anyone, you pass the interview at the embassy of US at your country, they will give you visa. Like it means anyone is coming in the United States, they have something at their country to come here. And if they're coming in that, don't treat them like a newborn, and give them, talk with them. Like I'm sure like talking with them, and they will share a lot of information with you where they want to be. Even if they were a doctor in Afghanistan, but they had a desire to work in another place. It means like when you're talking, then you can find a way for them. Like, yes, I studied medical doctor, but I didn't want to be in the hospital. Because in Afghanistan, we didn't have a lot of choices, but with the small choices or short choices, we made it, and we studied. But it means when you're coming, like just talking with them to find what they want, like always don't give the answer, just ask what they want. Then when the talking, like you can find the solution, or you can find a way for them to introduce a place that they can just go there.
Do you feel sometimes like people make assumptions about you as a Muslim woman or an Afghan, or someone who's a non-native speaker of English? Do people have stereotypes about who you are? And if so, how do you overcome that?
Honestly, Professor, I wish that confidence I have right now, I had 2-3 years or a few years ago. I could talk with the people. Like, I think you have to pass the time sometimes to receive. And I heard a lot from the people. Even they was like high profile, they believe my ability, they believe I'm capable of doing that things, but they didn't give me that opportunity to try it. Even there is so many project or so many activities were belong to Afghanistan, that was belong to my people, I could help that one. I could be involved at that project, or I could be involved with that community, but they couldn't, they didn't involve me, and they stay there and work. And I couldn't tell them, excuse me, I know more than you, my culture. I know more than you, the vision or the attitude of my people. I know what they need. I know what they know. But how you can go approach them and talk with them without knowing the culture, without knowing what they want. Like this experience I had, like I want to like to give them opportunity, talk with them. They know a lot, like give the opportunity from Afghan for the Afghan refugee, from the Middle East to the Middle East. Like even like if I'm not part of Middle East, but I know the culture. I think I can talk with the families. I can talk with the girls. I can talk with their fathers and convince them and help them. I could be better supported than you. Yes, you have good knowledge and you have a good experience at that nonprofit or that organization, but you don't know everything.
We need to listen to the experts, clearly. Where do you see yourself 5 years from now? When you think about the future, what do you hope for yourself, for your family, for your country? What do you envision?
First, if I had the chance to receive my travel document, I would be at the FIFA Football International Associations. I will, and I could travel around the world, and I could be at any World Cup, a woman football World Cup, if I have my document. And I could finish my degree, and I could finish my bachelor and my master in 5 years, hopefully. And I could go and visit my families after 7 years, almost. And my family will be, they will have their citizens in the Italy, and they will have, they will be fine. Plus, I will have a huge community in the United States. And if I get my all my documents and all my degrees, I could work in a higher organization in a better position, which I deserve.
I hope all of that happens for you. And I have no doubt that it will. How do you feel talking about your story? What emotions come up for you?
Different emotions, happy, proud, sad, all combined. Like if you make soup, you have a lot of difference. Like it's, and like I'm right now like a soup. I have all the emotionals, but the most, the highest emotional is, I know I'm proud of myself. I'm proud of my experience, but the other part is I'm really sad that I lost a lot of good opportunities, because I am almost 30 years old, but I lost a lot of good opportunities so I can be better in my life.
I love that idea of a soup with lots of different flavors and lots of different emotions. I think that's a really nice way to describe it. It's very helpful. Is there anything else you would like to add today? Our hour is up, but and I don't want to take more of your time because I know how busy you are and you've already had a long day, but is there anything else you'd like to add to this conversation?
I think I said everything. There's nothing in my mind right now.
Well, thank you again so much for your time. And I really look forward to watching you as your career continues. I have no doubt the future is going to be very bright for you. Thank you so much for your time today.
Thank you, Professor, for giving me this opportunity to talk and review all my experience here, because sometimes we cannot think, but when we talk, everything is coming in over my mind. But thank you for make this happen.
It's been so fun to reconnect with you.
Thank you, Professor.